Marvel Dice Throne lets you battle classic and well-known Marvel heroes through a Yahtzee-like dice system mixed with card-driven randomness, mitigation, hero upgrades.
The version of Marvel Dice Throne we've been playing is the Scarlet Witch, Spider-Man, Thor, and Loki 4-player set published by the Op, who we have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy. This Marvel Battler was designed by the team of Gavin Brown, Nate Chatelier, and Manny Tremblay. Features artwork from Manny, as well as Damian Mamoliti.
Dice Throne started as a series of games published by Roxley Games. The original features fantasy tropes, whereas this licensed Marvel version, which is published by the Op, features Marvel superheroes. Marvel Dice Throne is compatible with the entire Dice Throne ecosystem.
This four-hero box lets you play 2, 3, or 4 players, with more if you own additional sets. Games taking about 15 minutes per player once you know the game. While the game mechanics here aren't heavy, each character is very different and features their own set of status effects, tokens, and rules, which gives it a bit of a learning curve each time you try a new character.
A Marvel Dice Throne involves players upgrading and battling their heroes through clever card play and dice manipulation, where they'll roll their dice and spend them to attack and defend against other heroes. You can fight one-on-one, play King of the Hill, or battle in teams.
One of the highlights of the game are the game trays organizers that are used to sort out each of the heroes and their components. You can get a good look at these in our Marvel Dice Throne unboxing video over on YouTube.
Yeah, the trays really are awesome, and they get people excited about the game as soon as they crack it open. Except for a small punch board on top, this game is ready to play right out of the box, and I love being able to just open it up and drop 4 boxes on the table and say, pick a hero.
Even the components inside the trays are top of the line. Each hero has their own unique playboard, a sideboard, a variety of tokens, a unique set of etched dice, a unique deck of cards of good quality, as well as separate pre-assembled dials for tracking combat points and health. Now, I will note there the standee that you find in each tray is only for adventures and missions. It's not something you're going to use during the base Dice Throne play.
The component quality really is top-notch. And Mo's right, being able to hand out those character boxes, like as soon as they hit the table, folks are excited. They want to open them up and play. It had that effect on me, I know.
Yeah, the rulebook's a bit floppy, but clear and very detailed. Very detailed. Detailed in the people obviously run Dice Throne tournaments kind of way. I can be a bit to get through it first, and you're going to find yourself referencing back to the book quite often at first, especially when it comes to the various damage types. There's actually like a grid of damage types and how you can defend. Other than that, though, I was just a bit thrown off by the fact that all of the examples are for a hero that doesn't even come in the box I bought.
Well, with that, let's move on to an overview of how to play Marvel Dice Throne. We're going to start with a basic 1v1 2-player game.
You start by grabbing a hero box, opening it up, and setting all the stuff out in front of you. Unfold the hero board and place the sideboard next to it. You place your hero's status tokens onto the sideboard, shuffle your cards, draw 4, set your health dial to 50, and set your combat point, or CP, dial to 2. And note that some heroes have additional setups.
Now, each turn, you're going to start by getting 1 CP and drawing a card, though this is skipped for the first turn for the first player. You then get to play cards from your hand, spending the CP cost on the cards. Note, you can always discard cards from your hand to gain 1 CP if you do need more.
Most cards you play during this phase will be cards that get you additional CP or upgrade your character abilities. Upgrades are played right on your player board, covering up the old ability. You may also surprise your foes with action cards.
Next is the offensive roll phase, where you get to roll your dice up to 3 times. You then pick one of your abilities on your player board to activate. Each requires a different set of symbols on the dice, a set of the same number, or a short or long straight.
Now, assuming the resulting attack isn't undefendable or pure, your opponent gets a defense roll. Pick a defensive ability, roll the indicated dice, read off the ability to see how they're spent. Note, most defense rolls in this set in particular don't just reduce damage. Some don't reduce damage at all.
Now, next you get another chance to spend cards from your hand to improve your character, use additional actions, or what have you.
Some cards can also be played during the offensive role plays, interrupting and manipulating either your or the other player's dice. And when you're resolving that phase, make sure you leave time for your opponents to respond to your actions.
And that's where the rules get really detailed on the timing of everything. So refer back to that section if you do have a bit of a conflict there. Now, that's the basics. You continue doing this until one of the heroes is reduced to zero health and the other player wins. The thing is, though, like many dueling card games, this is an exception-based game. Every character is unique, and they each have their own abilities and cards that can do all kinds of things that mess with the basic rules.
Spider-Man can turn invisible and defend against undefendable attacks. Thor can toss and retrieve his hammer. Scarlet Witch can steal other characters' abilities. Loki can set up illusions that make him very hard to hit, and way more.
When you play with more than two players, there's an extra phase where you roll a die to determine who you attack, which prevents folks from teaming up on any one player. You can play King of the Hill, or Last Player Standing, or with four players, you can play in teams. Teams share one health pool and can freely share information and strategy. And in team mode, you will find that you are using those dice manipulation cards to help your ally as much as you are to hinder your foes.
Now, when I first started introducing Marvel Dice Throne to people, I used to call it Superhero Yahtzee. And honestly, that's doing it a disservice. Well, yes, the basic dice rolling mechanic is the same one as Yahtzee. Take your dice, roll them, then re-roll a total of three times. And yes, you're trying to get sets, right? You're trying to get three of a kind, or you're trying to get three symbols, or you're trying to get two of the symbol and three of another. But that's honestly where the comparison ends.
Yeah, I told Mo he has to stop using that line because the phrase Yahtzee but with superheroes did not make me want to try this game out. I actively dodged it for a while. But when we finally got it to the table, I discovered there are tons of ways to mitigate the luck of the dice and that the game is actually fairly strategic.
Yeah, because honestly, just thinking of this as just a dice game is wrong because it's just as much a dueling card game and has a lot of similarities to living card games and trading card games. The cards are how you upgrade your characters, how you manipulate the dice, and depending on your character, can actually be the main source of your abilities, as I was surprised to discover the first time I played Miles Morales.
Yeah, I like the way the cards allow you to upgrade the powers on your player board, and there's some fun and really thematic card combos that can happen. Loki has a card that's Liar Liar, and then later on in the deck you find a card that's Pants on Fire, and you want to make sure you play them both in the same round. That amused me the first time I read it, you know.
So one interesting thing to note, as I've seen it discussed in many places, is that this is in no way a deck construction game. Despite the fact that all of the card backs are the same, which might give the opinion that, oh, well, why can't we just shuffle them around? They must be meant to be because, again, all the card backs are the same. There is no mixing and matching.
Yeah, which is honest. It's good and bad. I will say I did have the one worry of what if I accidentally mix my cards? But I did find that you can get cardless on the Roxley website. Now, the real highlight to me of Marvel Dice Throne is how thematic it is, how each character plays very differently from the other three. Now, I've only experienced these four, but with these four in particular, it's the way they actually fit, at least what I know of the Marvel comic heroes they're based on. And now these do seem to be based on the comic heroes, not the cinematic universe characters, which is also indicated by the artwork. And this honestly covers all aspects of the games. From the icon distribution of the dice, not even every character has the same number of different icons or distribution of them. The content of the hero's decks are all different. And then everyone has their own little set of status effect tokens that go on a sideboard and that can be put into play. And then, of course, there's the different abilities on each player board. Some characters, like, for example, Scarlet Witch can't defend. Like, she has a defense and it's going to let you do cool stuff, but it's not going to stop any damage. Whereas Miles Morales actually has two different choices where he can counterattack or try to block the damage.
Yeah, I know with my first game as Loki, it really felt thematic. The way he was messing with my opponent's skills, presenting illusions to dodge attacks, it really captured the vibe of the character.
Yeah. Yes, I loved playing Loki. I enjoyed playing other players as well, but that first play with Loki is what won me over on this game. Like, I was dodging it, and I sat down and played, and I went, oh, I really like this. All of the powers just felt on theme. They felt right. It was just very thematic and very fun, and super asymmetric, as Mo was already getting into.
Yeah, because the problem, though, is that the asymmetry gives this game some unexpected weight. Like, it sounds like a fast and furious dice-chucking battle game, and I think somewhere on the box it even indicates it's a fast-playing, furious superhero battle. But I have seen this game bogged down with analysis paralysis. If you take your time to figure out the odds and play the angles and wait for those right combos, there's a lot of depth to be found in Marvel Dice Throne. Now, personally, I think that's a good thing, but it can really depend on what you want out of this game.
Yeah, this game can lead to some serious AP, particularly if you're playing with my daughter. Or me, I was guilty of it too. Like you're sitting there thinking, do you push your luck and try and roll again? Or do you settle for that power you can set off now? And if you are rolling again, which dice are you keeping? And which ones are you rolling? And are you going to use that card to manipulate the dice? Or are you going to save that card for next round? And then after that, when you roll and it doesn't go the way you expected it to, you have to recalculate. So, yeah, it can take a minute, particularly when, you know, you're getting further on in the game and you're getting trounced. It could take you a minute to figure out what you want to do.
Now, another thing I do want to touch on again, we already talked about the awesome game trays inserts, but I just want to mention that the component quality here is awesome. Like, it really is top of the line. Now, I bring this up because I know the company is talking about putting out a lower price point version of the game without any of the trays. And I honestly think this is a mistake. I think that would be the wrong move. The presentation of this game immediately sets the tone, the expectation, and the feel before you've even played. Every single person I've shown this game to has been wowed by it. This ranges from younger kids to my mother-in-law. They just see it and like, wow, this is nice. I think that presentation, that initial feeling, the obvious show of quality is going to drive people to want more. I know before I even played, I wished we had expansions. You can watch my unboxing video where I'm opening it going, yes, I need more of this. I hadn't even played the game. I hadn't even read the rule book yet, and I wanted more. Yes, the gameplay is solid. We'll get into the gameplay. And yes, we enjoyed the game. But that presentation just brings it to another level.
Yeah, after just one play, the urge to pick up additional characters, Marvel or otherwise, is real. And the Marvel Missions solo content sounds really interesting as well. Mm-hmm. This game could get expensive if you're not careful.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. The gotta have them all factor hit me hard with this one. Like Mo said, as soon as you put out those trays on the table, I was like, oh, there's more of these. We could pile more of them on the table to pick from.
Yep. Now, I've been hearing good things about Dice Throne, like all versions, not just the Marvel version, for a number of years here. And I've been eager to check it out. So again, I got to thank the op for this opportunity, because this is an example of a game that not only met, but exceeded my expectations for it. I was really expecting a light, almost party game, a light superhero dice chucker. I was expecting superhero Yahtzee. I thought we were going to have a quick romp, not a super asymmetric and highly thematic superhero battle that does feel like two of my favorite heroes are fighting each other. It's the depth in Marvel Dice Throne that keeps me coming back and has me wanting to pick up more heroes. And I got to say, I'm really tempted by the new Marvel X-Men sets that came out to coincide with X-Men 97. I'm really tempted by these.
I very much want to get the X-Men sets. I want to play this game with more characters, and I'm usually the voice of reason.
Yeah, I agree with B there. It's fun with four characters, but more choices, more fun. Isn't that how it works?
Yeah, should be. Plus, you know what? We get more players. We can start playing 3x3. So if you're a Dice Throne fan, I don't see a reason not to pick up Marvel sets. Like, why not? Get this one, the four hero set, get the others, get all of them, get all eight new heroes. They're fully compatible with the rest of the line as a big draw, and I think that's awesome. And as someone who's only tried Marvel, I'm tempted to go the other way and pick up some of the other sets, because I got to say, having Loki take on Santa sounds pretty cool to me.
Yeah, I'm not sure on that one. How about Santa versus Thor?
Miles Morales versus Krampus. Come on. There's so many possible combinations. The Barbarian versus Scarlet Witch. Like, I want to play out these battles. If you're a Marvel fan and you want a game that lets you battle your favorite heroes against one another, this is going to be a good choice. This is a solid battling 1v1 or team-based card and dice game. It can be played casually with a nice short play time when you're not trying to figure out every odd and you're just rapid-fire playing cards and dice. Or you can take the time to learn each character's in and out and turn it into a meatier-than-expected contest.
I like that it's quick to teach and quick to pick up. Everything is really on those boards in front of you, and it's easy to explain. But if it can be pretty strategic if you want it to be.
Yeah, I think the Marvel Dice Throne is a real gateway for people who might not be hardcore hobby gamers to find out about Dice Throne as a product line. Mm-hmm. While reading about other people's thoughts on this product and others in the line, I saw more than a few people who mentioned that they bought it because it was superheroes, because it was Marvel. Yep. And then went on to buy all of the original Season 1 and Season 2 Dice Throne products. So
yeah. I could see that.
Now, I know Deanna, what she needs is the DC version. We get a Batman in there and she'll be sold. I don't even have to ask. Now, I also think this is going to appeal to fans of that 1v1 dueling game, right? The generally dueling card games. Fans of older games like Overpower versus System, I think are going to find a modern superhero battle game they can enjoy here.
Yeah, I know the art here is much better than Overpower. that's for certain. And I believe it's all original, unlike the comic panels used in Verse and its Marvel offerings. Plus, no deck construction or collecting to worry about. Get your character and go.
Yeah, if you're looking for a pure strategy, low luck battle, though, where you're going to outplay and outthink your opponent and do various maneuvers on the board, that's not what you're going to find here. Maybe there's some other miniature-based Marvel games out there or something else you might be interested in. While there are lots of ways to mitigate the randomness, it's not just Yahtzee, but you are still dealing with a deck of cards and dice, so you're going to have some randomness. Now, the same is also true if you want something cooperative. That does not currently exist in this box, where you're all working on the same side. I admit a bit of confusion with the theming of this game, because why are these heroes all battling each other? I'm sure comic fans can come up with a reason, but if you do want to play these heroes together, check out the new Marvel Dice Thrones Missions, which was part of a recently very successful Kickstarter.
Yeah, I am super curious about those missions. They sound interesting, though I suspect I would rather pound on someone than play co-op.
Yeah, I think the biggest benefit of missions for many, myself included, is going to be the solo play aspect, which you don't get without missions or adventures.
Yeah, and plus, if you don't want to wait for the Marvel-themed cooperative version, there is Dice Throne Adventures. Though I don't know the theming on that one or how well it'll tie in, but it is all fully compatible. Now, what really made Dice Throne for all of us, I think, is how thematic it is. Like how playing Loki felt totally different from playing Thor, and playing the two of each other against each other felt like an actual battle between two brothers. Like, I honestly felt like we were playing through the Marvel Knights cartoon that's out there. Worth watching if you get a chance. What's a game you like due to the fact that its theme is tied in this well?
I don't know about you, but that review left me a little parched. I could really use a coffee. Help keep us caffeinated and motivated by supporting the show through coffee. That's ko-fi.com/tabletopbellhop.
Or for those in the chat, just hit the link that just went by.
While Xylotar may have the most ridiculous theme we've ever heard, it's one of the best modern trick-taking games we've played, one that innovates by not letting you look at your own cards.
Xylotar was designed by Christopher Ray and is coming soon from Bezier Games, who we have to thank for hooking us up with an early review copy. It's a